Well, the history, the reason why I named it The History of Rare and Unreleased is because I wanted to give the fans some that I had never put out to the public. And there's songs that have been out, but there's I wanted to give them a timeline, you know, straight up, just basically, you know, when I started doing this from the, a junior MC, right, and, you know, and being in a group, His Majesty, to, you know, breaking away from that, doing my own solo thing, rolling with my boy Pope, then, you know, just gradually moving up until the, you know, this time now where I'm fucking with JP the Hustler, you know, and we actually doing business together. So that's pretty much why I wanted to do this for the fans, man. The fans deserve to hear where I started from. There's just no question about it, because, you know, everybody want to talk about all that, oh, I originated this and I originated that, or I'm a legend this and I'm a legend that. All that shit's bullshit, dog. You know what I mean? The bottom line is I'm an individual, dude. This is what I do. And fuck the facade on that bullshit, man. You know what I'm saying? Niggas be, I trip on that because that's what I guess sells them, you know, the facade thing, man. I do insane poetry. There's no reason to explain my shit. It's pretty simple. It's insane and it's poetry. That's what it do. It's always been, man.
Well, basically, there's the first song is called High Plains Grifter. I actually did this with Messias, and he's in a group called Sweet Justice, and he actually runs G4 TV, the Freestyle 101. He approached me with this song, actually written, the original version was actually written by Eddie Spaghetti. And he was like, I got this joint called High Plains Grifter, it's like the old Western joint, and he just thought I fit on it. And actually, when I heard the track and the music, I just had to, it just took me in the realm of what my career has been like. So I've been on a pen game with it. So when it came out, it was like, bam. Oh yeah, we got it, was a track. Oh man, we recorded that back in 2004. It was Grim Reality Entertainment. We had just started the label at the time. We had a label full of MCs. You know, some was out here from right where we were locally, and some in San Diego, and we just put it together, and it was a lot of, you know, good stuff we wanted to put together, and one happened to be my boy Lowdown, you know, from Fullerton, Lowdown to Grinch Beach Boulevard, you know, that's Lowdown's thing, and it was for their mixtape, him and my boy Jay Sparks. At the time he was going by Spark, but it was their mixtape called The Jack Move. So I got them on there, I got JP the Hustler, he's on there. He actually did the track. He dropped a He Rock on there. Me, myself, Trey Dizzle, Cisco, and Freaks. Now, all of them, they was from, they all formed their own thing called Damn It Boy Entertainment, but they all was a part of Grim Reality Entertainment at that, you know, at the 2004 start, and that's where We Got It came from. Lord Forgive Me is a song about, you know, just life in general, man. You just go through a lot of things, man, and a lot of all that shit was unfabricated shit, you know, nonfiction. You know, I just spit it from how it happened, how it went down, and, you know, and it's like I wrote that shit to different tracks, but this track seemed to fit it the best, and you know, and I just wanted to give people that. You know, every time I do records, I want to give them some of Andrew Holloman, you know, not Psycho. So, you know what I'm saying, what, and that, those are the songs that, you know, you have to I feed my fans like that. That's why I wanted to drop this air rare and unreleased for songs like Lord Forgive Me. When I recorded Lord Forgive Me, I think it was in 2004 also, JP, you know, he produced the track at the time. He was really, really, you know, putting his production skills to another level. And it's funny because this song, particular song, we wanted to put on Falling From Grace and never made the cut. But it's funny how you get songs that you could always use for something else because they touch people in a different way, and it just didn't fit the chemistry of the record. That ain't me. That's my West Coast anthem for all the writers out there that are really sick and tired of all them suckers out there really, you know, lying on their records, platinum, go, you know, you catch a nigga selling this shit, you know, he look like he like that, but it ain't really going down like that. Everybody trying to put the facade on. I just that ain't me, man. I just wanted to give you 100%. Talking about the industry, how I felt at that moment, and that just wasn't me. You know what I'm saying? When you hear it, you know what I'm saying. West Coast stands up. I recorded That Ain't Me in 2004. Very different time in rap. It's crazy because a lot of you start seeing the trends, the transition of things getting bad back in those times. You know, for the big industry people. It's all good though. Life is a Gamble happened back in 2002. it was a record. It's funny how that came out. Life is a Gamble was actually, me and JP put that together on the Faith and Chaos record. And actually that was a different version than the original version I did with actually Coolio, how it came about. The producer, Jammin' James and Poison Ivy, or KMC, Jammin' James of Lighter Shaded Brown fame, they put this beat together and they just asked me to come to the studio and hang out with them. So they're playing a whole bunch of beats and this beat came on, they got me in the studio. I'm kind of just, you know, I've been writing, I was in a transitional stage from the Rodney O thing, and it just, this was happening to be a proper song for me to do a life song about. And I actually just closed my eyes and spit the first verse and knocked on the studio window after I got done with the verse. Over my eyes, it's Coolio, straight up. Coolio was like, I got a hook for this shit right off the bat. I didn't even know he was in the building, dog. He just was in another studio. He had heard me spitting the shit, and he just like, man, I got something. He came and laid that shit down, and this is how we have Life's a Gamble. But, you know, it's the original version. You know, it appear on this digital release, you know, as a remix version, because technically the first one was out, but we wanted to give you the different versions of it, and, you know, and the one on the Faith and Chaos was hot because it fit the ambiance of the type of record it was, and this one is, you know, just to let you know where it originated from. Yeah, well, Can't Flow With Us, that was a single that me and JP, we got together, first time we actually jumped on a song together. And it was the first single after the Faith and Chaos record. We felt like we needed to start branching out and hitting people up. Like, this is Grim Reality Entertainment getting ready to start dropping on you. So here's a little prelude to it. And so that's basically what me and JP has done, is put together a combination and a chemistry that works really well. And Camp Florida, that was the, you know, origin of that. Now, we wanted to let people know about it. We want, you know, digitally everywhere, because this is all global, so we want people to feel what we're doing. Shroom Vision, yeah, that's one of my favorite joints, man. I did that during the era, and Boogie produced that track. And Boogie was a dude that I met years ago with my dude Shakespeare, way back, like in the early 90s and stuff. And Boogie was DJing, and he got into production, and he's done a lot of production on some of my prior stuff that will be coming out. You'll be able to check that out. The thing about Shroom Vision is during this time I was experimenting with drugs a lot, straight up. And I just wanted to write something that was really hot. And it was like, it's funny because I got a lot of flack from this record. I think a lot of heads in the industry and a lot of the underground backpack cats didn't like me because they thought I was taking a shot at Dilated Peoples on this, which really I wasn't. I didn't really understand, because again, I was in a drugged out state most of that era, and writing, you know, it's just, you know, you do what you do or whatnot. And the hook on the song, I didn't even write. And Boogie wrote the hook, and it's just fucked up because it ties in, and then I say their name in a line and everything like that. And when I wrote it, I wasn't even writing it towards them. I just liked their song called Work the Angles. And it's like, I say the line, I lethally work the angles. And then I'm just, after the rhyme, I'm just on to another thought process on the rhyme. And it's funny because when I listen to the song now, I'm like, no wonder why they thought it seemed like I was coming at them. But one, the hook is pretty much saying it's three of them, and then it's like, I can see three of you, you know what I mean? So I know they looking at me like, oh, homie, you in the wrong, and I wasn't even on that page. Not to say that I don't respect what they do. I respect exactly what they do, because they represent real hip hop. But at the same time, you know, that's the olive branch. I've been telling people this for years. It's never been no hate towards Dilated, but you know, I can only say, yeah, it is what it is. And it's funny because you mentioned Shroom Vision, which leads me into